Good morning, God's beloved. Welcome to worship with University Christian Church in Austin, Texas. I'm Reverend Megan Pegler, the senior minister here, and I'm so glad that you have joined us for worship today. If you would let us know that you worshiped with us, so please take a moment to sign in on the link that is in the description of this video. You can also find it on our website, along with a lot of other helpful information. And our website is ucc-austin.org. Next week is going to be a big week in the life of the church. We will be back in the sanctuary for worship for the first time since early August, and we will still be live streaming as well for those of you who feel more comfortable at home. And we'll also, on that day, be celebrating our 75th anniversary. This is kind of the first part of our year-long celebration. We had some trouble planning the 75th in the midst of COVID, and so this is kind of the kickoff to a fuller celebration that will happen next year. We'll also, next week, be recognizing our new life elders. So it's going to be a special day in the life of the church, and I hope to see you here. We will have COVID protocol in place. Everyone will be asked to be masked while in the building, no matter vaccination status. We'll have a check-in table outside of the sanctuary where you'll get your bulletin and communion kit and everything else. So anyway, I hope to see you here. If you have any questions, please reach out. And speaking of next Sunday, don't forget that next weekend is daylight savings time. We will be falling back, so make sure to set your clocks appropriately. Also, a reminder about this upcoming week. Election Day is Tuesday, so if you haven't had a chance to vote yet, make sure you get yourself to the polls. Now, let us take some time to prepare our hearts and minds to worship God.
Siblings, hear this call to worship from Isaiah 25. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And God will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all people, the sheet that is spread over all nations. God will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of God's people will be taken away from the earth.
Rest. Please join me in the litany of praise. Fling wide the temple gates, open up the ancient doors. The mighty and glorious one is coming. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in God.
Celebrating All Saints Day. And in this day, we remember the saints who have gone before us into the church triumphant. And as such, we will have a litany of remembrance this morning. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. God calls us to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the company of all the saints, we cry, "Praise God! Salvation, glory, and power belong to our God."
We give thanks to you, O God, for all your servants and witnesses of the past, for Abraham, the father of believers, and for Sarah, his wife, for Moses, the lawgiver, and Aaron, the priest, for Miriam and Joshua, Deborah and Gideon, for Samuel and Hannah, his mother, for Isaiah and all the prophets, for Mary, the mother of our Lord, for Peter and Paul and all the apostles, for Mary, Martha, and Mary Magdalene, for Stephen, the first martyr, and all the saints and martyrs in every time and in every land. In your mercy, give us, as you gave them, the hope of salvation and the promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
On this day, we remember the unseen cloud of witnesses, those who in every age and generation witnessed to their faith in life and in death, those who served their sister and brothers at the cost of pain, of persecution, and of death, those for whom all the trumpets sounded as they passed over to the other side, those whom we have loved and who have gone to be with you, whose names are written on our hearts. Help us to walk worthily of those in whose unseen presence life is lived. Help us to have in our lives their courage in danger, their steadfastness in trial, their perseverance in difficulty, their love which nothing can change, their joy which nothing can take away.
So grant to us in your good time to share with them the blessedness of your nearer presence, that we also may come to that life where all the questions are answered, where all the tears are wiped away, where we shall meet again, never to be separated from those whom we have loved and lost a while, where we shall be forever with our Lord. Grant to us in this life never to forget those who have gone before, so that in the life to come we may share their blessedness through Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll now take a moment to remember our loved ones who have died in this past year, since last All Saints Day. You'll see the names that were submitted to the office on the screen. So let us take some quiet time as we see those names come across the screen to give thanks for those who are resting in God's eternal embrace.
Thank you.
Siblings, the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Watching for a new heaven, waiting for a new earth, we pray to God. O Lord our God, have mercy on us and wipe away our tears. Today we pray for the church. Transform this broken body into a communion of saints. A company of the faithful, working for good in your world. We pray for the world. Remind us that you have destroyed the shroud of death that is spread over the nations. God, replace the rule of wealth and of war with your realm of justice and peace. We pray for this community. God, make your home among us. Dwell with us here in this place. Let our city be one of heavenly peace and a place of refuge for all your creation. We pray for loved ones. Soothe those who are suffering. Comfort those who mourn. Let us be glad and rejoice in the gifts that you give us. As you have sustained your saints through centuries of service, keep us faithful here and now until your will is done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray these things in the name of Jesus the Christ, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Peace.
Today's scripture is from the book of John, chapter 11, verses 32 through 44. When Mary came to Jesus, where Jesus was, and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, there is a stench, because he has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Every year on All Saints' Day, we remember those who have gone on before us, including and especially, I think, those who taught us and showed us with their lives how to love God and neighbor. We also give thanks for the living saints in our lives who influence us and who help us to know how to better walk in the way of Jesus. But let's not get too caught up on the word saints, because the people that we are remembering and giving thanks for, we're not perfect people. They were regular, fallible folks like you and me. And we need to keep that in mind. The last several weeks, we've been in the Gospel of Mark, reading along in the lectionary, that 3-year cycle of scripture readings. But today, we switched to the Gospel of John, which is the text for All Saints' Day, officially tomorrow, but we're recognizing it today. In the Gospel of John, there are 7 signs that John tells about that show who Jesus is. The first sign, you know it, the water into wine. And then this raising of Lazarus was the 7th sign. The Salt Project commentary says that John's name for these events, signs, clarifies their purpose. They're supposed to catch our attention, even catch our breath, drawing us toward life with and in God. Like road signs, these events point beyond themselves to bigger, deeper realities. This story John tells, the sign pointing to Jesus as Messiah, it does that, but it also reveals to us how very human Jesus was as well. Jesus cried for his friend. It says that he wept. He was disturbed in spirit. He was deeply moved. It is appropriate when we are grieving a loss to feel that loss. to respond to it, to express what is going on inside of us. Jesus did. We do not need to deny or hide our emotions from ourselves or others. For some of us, that is easier said than done, but it's something to work toward, I think. Jesus, in all his humanity, asked, "Where have you laid him?" He wanted to see, to be near to his friend, to witness up close, to remember his friend. How human. It's what we do. When someone we love dies, we get close. We get close to those who are around us who are also mourning. We get close to people who we can reminisce with. We get close to memories of the one who embodied love to us. And hopefully, in the midst of this grieving, we get close to the truth too, whatever the truth is. The memories we get close to aren't always happy ones. The relationships weren't always the best. And it's important to be honest about that. Pastor and writer Reverend Carol Howard Merritt tells about her tumultuous relationship with her dad. He'd been a violent man through her growing up years, and they still had tensions into her adulthood. She writes about when he died. She says, "It was not like Lazarus and his weeping friends. Our eyes were dry. It was not a matter of bandages, a cave, and a stone. I was not like Mary or Martha. I didn't feel abandoned by Jesus because my dad had died." She says, "I was relieved that his suffering had ended and my mom could have her life back." As she went forward from the funeral, from all of the business that comes with death, she went about life in sort of a normal way. She thought things would go back to normal. She thought she had forgiven him. But it turned out that she hadn't. And her grief revealed that. She lost weight. She couldn't sleep well. She was crying at random times. She says she lived in a fog of irritability and forgetfulness. That kind of fog, I think, comes not only after the loss of a loved one, but as we're grieving any number of losses. She says that her friends prayed for her. And she says, for the first time, prayer felt like a palpable sustenance. I was getting through the days by consuming others' hopes and yearnings for me. As she came to the realization that she had not forgiven her father, she realized also that she had been nursing these resentments as a way to bind them together, even after his death, to keep some sort of relationship going. So when she read this story of Jesus and Lazarus, she saw the truth opened up. As she heard Jesus' words, "Unbind him and let him go." Unbind him and let him go. Those words were echoing in her heart, and so she unbound him. She let go of those resentments. She let go of her bitterness, and she found, after the unbinding, still love remained. Relationships can be very complicated, and so can death. and so can life. And Jesus is with us to walk with us through all of it. Jesus is with us through the questions we ask. He's with us through the tears, through the heartache, through our longings to have maybe a different relationship with the one that has now gone on. He's with us through the longing to be close again to someone who was a light in our lives. Jesus is there with us, comforting us, but also reminding us again of the good news that we know because of him. That death does not have the last word. It never does. This sign, this seventh sign in the Gospel of John that Jesus performed by raising up Lazarus, points to his not far off death and resurrection. When he was going to Mary and Martha after Lazarus' death, he asked, "Where have you laid him?" And just this morning, Jimmy Cobb pointed out helpfully to me that this has a real reverberation with what happens later on in John. You'll remember after Jesus was crucified and buried that Mary went to the tomb looking for him. And she saw a gardener. She thought it was a gardener. She didn't ask, "Where have you laid him?" But she, in more of an imperative, said, "Tell me where you have laid him." She was looking for Jesus. She didn't realize she was talking to him. She says, "Tell me, where have you laid him?" And then Jesus said her name, and she recognized him. Just like Jesus appeared to Mary, Jesus comes to us and is with us. God promises in Isaiah 25, you heard it in the call to worship today, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast, and he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces." The shroud is there for a purpose. The tears are there for a purpose. Just as Jesus showed us it is good to react in our grief, to show those emotions, to ask, "Where have you laid him? When will my tears stop? How can I stay feeling any kind of close to this one who I love who's now gone? Will I feel normal or happy again?" Jesus knows these questions intimately. He knows these feelings. And he knows and reminds us that God does swallow up death forever. And God wipes away the tears. Still knowing that, Jesus weeps over the death of his friend. He feels. Henry Nouwen wrote, "We must mourn our losses. We cannot talk or act them away, but we can shed tears over them and allow ourselves to grieve deeply." To grieve is to allow our losses to tear apart feelings of security and safety and lead us to the painful truth of our brokenness. He goes on, "Our grief makes us experience life in which nothing is settled, clear, or obvious, but everything is constantly shifting and changing. But in the midst of all this pain, there is a strange, shocking, yet very surprising voice. It is the voice of the one who says, "Blessed are those who mourn, they shall be comforted." That's the unexpected news. There is blessing hidden in our grief. There are many blessings of this day of remembering together all of our losses, all of the saints. The blessing that those who mourn are comforted. The many blessings of all the saints whose lives reflect God's love and forgiveness and compassion and God's will on earth as it is in heaven. And we know the blessing of the truth that God conquers death and that love has the last word. And so may you be blessed today with whatever good news you need most right now. May we all. Amen.
Received is from God's hand. We are called to be stewards of God's abundance, the caretakers of all that God has entrusted to us. Our faithful stewardship bears witness to the love of Jesus Christ in our lives. As a reflection of our hearts, let us use our gifts wisely and share them generously.
Please pray with me. Loving Father, today we are especially thankful for your promises. The promise about nothing ever being able to separate us from your love. The one about going to prepare a place and then coming back for us. And the one about your swallowing up death forever. We rejoice in your salvation and thank you for your abiding love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The stole I'm wearing today was given to me at my ordination service, and different women in the church I was serving at the time, my ordaining church, cross-stitched the different emblems that are there. I haven't talked to a lot of them in a long time, but I know that we're around this table together. Every week, we are bound together. Every time we come to this table, no matter what day of the week it is, we are with all of those others, other beloveds of God who are sharing in this same feast. All around the world, past, present, future. And we don't have to do anything to make it so. It just is through the love of God. So we are grateful recipients of this feast where everyone is invited. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." According to his commandment, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
Ever faithful one, we have welcomed to your table all of those who've gone before us. You nourish them without fail. Now we join with those departed ones in gratitude and love for the life and witness of Jesus the Christ, who showed us what it is to be your faithful disciples. We pray that you will give us the grace to love and welcome all people. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Beloved, may God grant you strength through the Spirit. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, and may you know, share, and rejoice in the immeasurable love of God. Go in peace to love and serve. Amen.